All right, so now we're going to talk a little bit about media conversions in regards to music. So I'm sure some of you remember Napster, the file sharing of the future. In 1999, two college kids brought illegal music sharing to the mass public. And now let's see how this began.
College students are making good use of the internet. The latest software makes it a bit too easy for students to access their favorite tunes.
The main challenge was, can this thing scale to a massive number of users? And I just thought, okay, if this piece of code works, this is going to be huge. And I had a moment there where I asked myself, is it morally correct? Technology is advancing. This is going to happen anyway.
You have a generation of people now who expect their music for free.
I don't care how wrong it is, I've got good intentions.
It's very difficult to change.
In 1998, at Northeastern University, a freshman, Sean Fanning, began developing a computer program called Napster in his dorm room. He asked for help from Ali Aydar, a veteran programmer he knew through his uncle.
And my response to him was, you need to just concentrate on your studies.
Fanning didn't follow Ali's advice. He dropped out to focus on the program and partnered with fellow teenage programmer Sean Parker to release a beta version. As it started to spread through chat rooms, they traveled to the Bay Area to grow the business.
Initially, I was skeptical that, gosh, I'm sitting across from two 18 or 19-year-olds. I changed my tune once I learned that there are already 40,000 people using this thing.
It was one of the first large-scale peer-to-peer file-sharing programs. It allowed users to access music files stored on the hard drives of fellow Napster users.
40,000 wasn't a big number, but it was bigger than what I thought it was going to be initially, which was zero, because people weren't willing to open up their hard drives. What I realized was that people's emotional ties to music, their general interest in music, was more than enough to overwhelm any kind of security or privacy concern.
And in the 90s, consumers' emotional ties to music equaled big money. No one batted an eye when Puff Daddy's record label made two music videos featuring elaborate helicopter chases in consecutive years.
The CD boom was from 84 to 2000. You actually had to drive your car to the Tower Records and buy a CD for $18 to get the one song you liked. And so that was a good model. It made the industry tons and tons of cash.
Selling millions of Chumbawamba albums with one good song was an economic boom.
That was pretty much the end of that era, because very soon afterwards, Napster really took hold in the public's consciousness, and the consumer realized that they could get the music that they wanted to hear for free.
It was on college campuses with high-speed internet that Napster really took off in the fall of 99.
So how many MP3s do you have on your computer?
About 600.
Maybe like 100 or something?
6 or 7,000.
Napster.
Napster. It's called file sharing, seen by some as the wave of the future.
It was very exciting. We knew we were building something that was going to be big.
Ladies and gentlemen, creator of Napster, Sean Fanning.
When I first heard about Napster, I recall my impression having two different elements. One being, this is incredible, it's revolutionary, and things will never be the same again in the music industry. And the other being, this is going to destroy the recording industry.
No longer do you have to go to a store and plunk down money.
And so, months after Napster's rise, the recording industry began a long legal battle to stop it.
They are waging a war in the courts over who controls what artists create.
We've heard that we couldn't survive before, when we had 700,000 members, and when we had 17 million members.
We felt pretty strongly that digital distribution was going to bring the industry closer to its customer. And instead of killing it, they would take advantage of the value that it brought.
But
But to record companies whose artists range from Tony Bennett to Metallica, this new technology in the wrong hands is simply stealing.
A business model built on infringement is not only morally wrong, but legally wrong.
At the time, the Recording Industry Association of America was reporting about $15 billion a year of revenue in the U.S. alone.
Anybody with enough money could go and make a record. But that didn't guarantee you getting into stores, which was the only place that you could actually buy that record. That was the power of the music business, the distribution.
The issue made its way to Capitol Hill.
Napster hijacked our music without asking.
A chorus of studies show that Napster users buy more records as a result of using Napster.
Hank Barry, a lawyer, came on to act as CEO as the fight intensified.
We were trying to negotiate with the labels. We were trying to fight the court case, and we were trying to keep the system working all at the same time. We had a limited amount of time to make that happen, and we just didn't get that done within the period of time that we had.
The free music service run by Napster was ordered to stop the music.
In July of 2001, after more than a year of legal battles, the internet startup, which at its peak had about 70 million registered users, shut down its entire network in response to court orders.
We accurately estimated that the courts would say, you just don't have the right to give away all this stuff. And so we were perhaps a little smug and confident in the belief that, well, the courts would say it's not that and people would stop doing it. We didn't really factor in the consumer adoption, the youthful lack of respect for copyright, and the anonymity would combine to make it pretty unstoppable as a model.
The industry may have crushed Napster, but the idea had taken hold, and a flurry of other downloading services took its place.
It's free and it's easy and, you know, it's wrong, yeah, but a lot of people do it. Pretty much everybody does.
Desperate to stem the tide, the labels upped the stakes and sued almost 20,000 people for using illegal downloading software.
Legally downloading music is the same thing as going into a CD store on a CD.
But CD sales continued to plummet, shuttering record stores across the country.
An industry in turmoil.
So when Steve Jobs came to the table with plans for a new online music store, the major labels finally surrendered the thing they had fought so hard to maintain, the distribution.
You had only two choices. Either you don't do a deal with Steve, in which case people continue to just email the MP3s to their friends, or you do a business with him and he has a store and then you can sell things.
This week, Apple Computer launched its iTunes Music Store.
And they are hoping that this is an answer to some of the piracy that is going on online.
Over the next several years, digital sales boomed.
More than 3 billion songs.
But today, even the iTunes model is threatened by the shifting sands of music distribution. Download sales are declining as online streaming services like Spotify gain popularity. And as the industry reels, corporate brands see marketing opportunities, with the energy drink company Red Bull even starting its own record label.
Who knows 5 years from now if anybody's going to buy music anymore? But maybe they are streaming it, which you see on the Spotify's and the YouTubes of the world. Those numbers keep going up and up and up.
A recent study found that the most popular way for 12 to 24-year-olds to discover new music is the online video website YouTube.
It used to be that the only way that you could do this free music sampling was through downloading illegally. Now there's other ways to sample music for free.
Consumers also use YouTube to upload and share music, some of which they don't own the rights to.
When YouTube first started, my view was that it was actually worse than Napster. This should be easy to shut down.
But after legal challenges, the company emphasized its efforts to try to stop infringement, offering the copyright owner the chance to take a video down or run ads against it.
The growth of music on YouTube has been 100% organic and driven by the community, by artists, by fans. The part that wasn't organic was YouTube's partnering with the music industry to enable the usage of copyrighted works.
Some in the music industry say the money-making potential of YouTube has yet to pay off for many artists. But today, the industry is largely embracing online platforms and their communities as a form of distribution that can't be ignored, and they're not the only ones.
Many, many records are made by people in their garages, basements, or bedrooms, and the distribution is there. They'll make a video, they'll stick it on YouTube, and if it's good, people will find it.
Macklemore and Ryan Lewis jump-started their career without a record label when their video went viral on YouTube.
You have artists like Macklemore, who was able to reach millions and millions of fans before getting to radio. He would have had a very difficult time achieving that if you were to rewind back to the 90s.
For many others, streaming services hurt their bottom line. Royalties are small fractions of what artists once made from sales, and some musicians have had to grapple with this new reality more than others.
I don't care how wrong it is, I've got good intention.
I haven't seen much money from record sales. Spotify and Pandora and all that stuff is great, but again, the amount of money I receive from that is very small.
I'm really very happy to be here with Miss Amy Lou Harris.
Robert Ellis is a singer-songwriter who's released critically acclaimed albums and tours with the likes of Willie Nelson and Emmy Lou Harris.
In the last few years, we've been on the road pretty much nonstop. I think we did 290-something days last year. I would say touring represents probably 100% of my income. When I was a kid, if I had told myself what I was doing now, I would think that I'd be making a lot more money than I am, yeah.
Music is as important, if not more important, than it's ever been. I think the challenge is of finding ways to monetize that importance.
Napster might have hurt recorded music sales, but it's the responsibility of the industry to figure out how to extract their value out of each generation. This happens in every industry.
The Rocky Mountain News published its final edition.
Blockbuster Video is no more.
Borders is going into liquidation.
Music was the first industry that really had to confront the idea of free content. Music was at the forefront of it, whether it liked it or not.
So, as we just watched, music was the first industry to really, really be affected by free, you know, enterprise, free content, I guess you could say. And this created how media now released its content. So, as music stores went out of business all over America, Apple sold billions of songs and hundreds of million iPads. Then came books and movies and television series, but that's another story. Radio and television each developed with the promise of being able to reach everyone, even poor or illiterate citizens. Despite continuing concerns over the digital divide, many have praised the internet for its democratic possibilities. Some say it's the most democratic social network ever to exist, but the increasing commercialization of it, if we are to follow the histories of other media, it is only a matter of time that the internet's potential for widespread use by all could be partially preempted by narrower commercial interests. In response to these, many argue that the internet offers exposure that would be unchartered still if not for the digital age. Many still say that the interaction of internet users allows for a wider net of democratic community engagement than ever before. A democratic community needs to include diverse viewpoints, something that might not be able to happen in the emerging ecosystem of apps that offer a virtual gated community. The discoveries are still young, and the opportunities are endless. So this is Media Convergence, the Internet and Democracy. What are the benefits to our culture and what and way of life with this new form of media? If you have any questions, we have the sources listed below as well as hyperlinked within this PowerPoint. Thank you for tuning in.